everyone. My name is Kate, and this is my husband, James, and we are so glad that you've tuned in for today's service. We really pray that it blesses you.
You know, if it's your first time watching, we would so love to connect with you. All the information can either be found on screen, you can scan the QR code, or you can click one of the links in the description box below. But we hope you really enjoyed this service and that God really speaks to you through it.
Come on, clap your hands.
It happened inside me. The moment you came in into my life, I felt your power, it lifted me higher. Now I'm on fire, burning for you.
La 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 la. Come on. La 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 la.
No, I'm not mistaken in who I'm praising. You are the reason that I'm alive. Jesus, you came in and everything's changing. So I'm praising and lifting you high.
Here we go.
God, you're so good. God, you're so good. There's nobody like you. There is no one like you. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. There's nobody.
Continue to worship you, Lord. I pray that you would just fill this place with your presence. Fill every household, every person that's watching right now. I pray that you would just speak to them, Lord. These songs that we're about to sing, let them come to life. They're just not words, Lord God. Let these songs be our prayer, Lord. So wherever you are, come on, let's lift our hands and let's get into the attitude of worship. Let's go.
I need more. More of your presence, Jesus, more. more than riches and gold. I need Jesus more than this world.
We care.
Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around that the Spirit of the Lord is here. Come on, sing that if you believe. A miracle could happen now, yes it can. For the Spirit of the Lord is here in your homes. Evidence is all around that the Spirit of the Lord is here.
Praise our God in his house today. You know, I was reminded of who God is, and I stumbled upon this chapter in the book of Psalms. Psalm 61, it says this: Hear my cry, O God, listen to my prayer. From the end of the earth, I call to you when my heart is faint. And it said, I love this line. It says, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. And you know, when I think about God as a father, God as a provider, I love that description of God as a rock. And I don't think of him just as a rock that I can put in my pocket, but a huge, massive boulder that I can stand on. And on this boulder, no matter how strong the winds are, this boulder does not move. No matter how strong the rains come, this boulder cannot move. And I can move around the boulder, but you see, this boulder will not move. And I don't know what your situation is, and maybe your circumstance is volatile, it's uncertain. Can I invite you, place yourself upon this rock that is higher than you. Place yourself upon this rock that is higher than your circumstance. place yourself upon this rock that is higher than your job, that is higher than whatever is going on in your life. And in just a moment, I want to sing that song again, just a part of that chorus. And as we sing, "There is no one else like you," would you begin to just place yourself on this rock that is higher than I? Come on, let's worship,
there
just declare.
Is no one else.
Whatever your need is right now, whether it's emotional, whether it's physical, if you've got an illness, if you've got a family member who's in trouble, come on, lift up your hands. There's no one else like our God, and He hears you. He sees exactly what you're going through. And so, God, I just lift up every need to you. We don't see them, but you see them because you are their Father. And so, God, I pray for physical healing to happen right now. I pray for your provision to overflow in families' lives. I pray for people's mental health, God. I pray that you would fill people with hope and purpose at this moment. And so we thank you, God. You are so good, and there is no one else like you. And everybody said, amen. Come on, can we give God a praise? Let's give God a praise. So good, so good. Hey, at this time, we're going to continue our worship with our offering. And, you know, offering really is an overflow of our thanksgiving. And we say that we give from the heart because we're so grateful for what God has done for us. And in just a moment, there's going to be a bunch of ways you can give, whether it's GCash, PayMaya, PayPal, or through our bank channels. And so, you know, I just want to invite you, if you can just take out your phones and your laptops and your tablets, let's take up our tithes and our offerings right now. Let's pray. God, we want to thank you that we get to give to you. That it's not an obligation, but it's an honor and it's a privilege to give to you, to join with you in the work of your kingdom. And so, God, I pray for every single peso that's given today. And I pray that it would go towards the winning of people for you and in your family. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hey, welcome to Favor Church Online. In case we haven't met, my name is Willem, and I'm part of the team here at Favor. And you know what? We are so glad that you are here today. If you are brand new to one of our services, hey, we want to say hi. We just want to welcome you. You are a VIP. And so right now on Facebook, there's going to be a little pop-up on your right-hand side. Can you just go ahead and let us know you're new? And if you're on YouTube or Kumu or any of the other channels, let us know you're new because we want to get a gift to you, a digital gift. Hey, but if you're in Metro Manila, we want to send something to you. Send something physical, and it's got some goodies. It's got some information about our church. And so let us know if you're new. We're so glad that you're here. Hey, in just a moment, Pastor James is going to come up, and you are going to want to lean in because he's got a great message, and God is going to speak to you. There's so much going on in our church. So let's check out this week's edition of Favor News.
Hey, Favor fam. Welcome to another edition of Favor News. We've got a lot of things happening in our church this coming week, starting off with Favor Business Gathering. We're going to be speaking with the founder of Kumu, Mr. Roland Ross. This will be happening on Facebook Live, August 8th, Saturday at 10:30 a.m. So if you're the owner of a business, you don't want to miss out.
Hey, to all our young adults, we've got something super exciting for you this coming Saturday on our online gathering. Our very own senior pastor is joining us to talk about sex!
And it's gonna be a lot of fun, so I want you to show up to invite everyone that you know about it, because we're gonna have a good time. And it's plus 18. Plus 18.
Yeah, well, plus 18 plus only. It's gonna be wild. Tune in on our favorite movement FB page. We'll see you there.
We also love hearing testimonies, because testimonies help build our faith. So if you've got a story to share, we want to hear from you. Email us at testimonies@favor.church or send us a message at favor.church/testimonies. Now, aside from this service, we've also got services going for kids, for high school students, and a service with Filipino Sign Language interpretation. So if you want to know where and when you can catch these, visit us at favor.church/schedule. So if you want to know more about our church, join a connect group, or find out everything we're doing in this season, you can visit us at favor.church/next. And to stay updated with everything going on, visit us at our social media channels popping up right now. And that is it for Favor News.
Hey, welcome to church today online. My name is James, if we've never met yet, and I'm a part of the team at Favor Church, and I'm so glad you're here. Today is a special, special day. I'm excited about what is about to happen. We are in the last sermon of our series called I Am a Carrier. And this has been a real special series. I've really enjoyed preaching this because it's been talking about the culture of our church. You know, if you've been tuning in the last few weeks, you would have heard me talk about how there's only one culture. A lot of people say, oh, there's different cultures in a place or an organization. No, there's only one culture, but a culture is made up of different values. And so we've talked about four in the last 4 weeks, about four of the key values. Today we're talking about the fifth one. The first week we talked about presence, that the presence of God was the key, the most, the highest value that we have in our church. Just like the Israelites honored the presence of God by camping around it, just like Moses said, I'm not going anywhere without it. So as a church, we don't want to do anything, say anything, make any decision without the presence of God. The second week, we talked about prayer, about how prayer is a chance for us to become intimate with God and also see signs and wonders and miracles happen. The third week, we talked about the value of people, that we are a carrier that loves people, that we don't just have people here just for the sake of it. Without people, we don't have a church. The church is not the organization. It's definitely not the building, but it is the people. And so we want to be authentic. We want to be relevant. We want to be accepting, even though we don't agree with everything. We want to accept all people. And last week, we talked about generosity. That we talked about what it meant to really be a carrier of generosity. Even in this last week, I've heard testimonies of people that heard the message and within 48 hours went out and started being generous, giving things away and having those moments of generosity, which I was so excited to hear about. Today, I want to jump straight into it. The title of my message today is this: I am a carrier of creativity. I'm a carrier of creativity. So we've got the values that make up our culture is the presence of God, prayer, people, generosity. Those are all like, yeah, they're pretty standard church things. But creativity, that's, even though every church says, yes, we want to be a creative church, right? For us to include that in kind of like the top five values that we value as a church, it must really mean a lot to our church. And I just want to give you kind of insight into our thinking and why we would say, I value creativity so much. It was always my dream to pastor a church where creativity just abounded in everything that we did, right? From programs to worship to multimedia to how we do business, all that kind of stuff. My dream was always to have a church bursting with creativity. But it's got to be more than just I like creativity in order to be a value in our church. We got to have a Bible basis for this. Why? Well, I want us to go all the way back to Genesis chapter 1, and it says this: So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him, male and female, he created them. It's amazing. We got the word created three times in three sentences in one verse. God, if you haven't worked it out, is a creative God. All you have to do is look around at the earth. He is so creative that he didn't even have to construct the planet with his hands. He used his mouth. He spoke out and there was light. He didn't create light. He didn't rub his hands together or shwang. He didn't do it. He spoke and light came forth. God is so creative. You want to know how creative God is? All you have to do is go into creation. Look at the animals. How creative is God? He created the ant. He created the dog. He created the rhinoceros. He created the hippopotamus. He then created the giraffe and the elephant and then the rat. And then he created the eagle and the zebra. You're like, wow, I'm so knowledgeable. It's because I have children and we read all these books with all these animals, right? God is so creative. And the Bible says that he created man and woman in his image. Let's just talk about that for a second. The fact that you are created, do you know how intricate your body is? I don't. I'm not a scientist. I'm not a doctor, but I've done a little bit of research and I've done just enough research to realize that I will never truly be able to understand every single dynamic that makes me up as a person, how I click, how this part connects to this and that. And I think to myself, I go, wow, if you truly understand even how a baby is made, my four-year-old daughter, first one in the family, asked the question 2 days ago, Mommy, where do babies come from? And I looked at Kate, I said, answer the child. And Kate did an unbelievable job of completely avoiding the question. And we'll deal with it in 10 years' time, right? If you understand just how complex we are as human beings, it blows my mind to think that some people could think we just were created from a Big Bang or we evolved from some tadpole-like creature that was swimming in the ocean to get lizards with legs and then become a monkey and then kind of evolve into, the complexities of who we are as a person shows me how creative God is. And here's why we hold creativity as one of these five values in our church is this, because you and me, we are created in the image of God, which means if God is a creative God, you and I are creative beings. And how we do church should be creatively. And this is where science comes in and tells us how creative we are through our brain. So science actually tells us that our brain is split into two. And we have our left brain and we have our right brain. Whoa! Whoa! What's up, brains? You guys look good. How you doing, right brain? Yo, I'm good, you know, just chilling, loving life, finding inspiration in everything around me. Just thinking about the meaning of existence and trying to decide whether I should write a song about it, make an art sculpture, or do an interpretive dance. As you can tell, the right brain is more visual and intuitive. Some would say good looking as well. It's sometimes referred to as the analog brain, right? It has a more creative and less organized way of thinking. And generally, people with a right dominated brain are called creative people, especially when you look at them. Over here, we got our left brain. How you doing, left brain? I'm good. Thank you very much for asking. In fact, earlier today at 7:53 a.m., as I was reading the book, How Am I Doing? By R. Lavelle Rambin, I came to the conclusion that, in fact, I am fine. I appreciate your concern for my well-being, but you should be more concerned about the current state of the stock market. As you can see, the left brain is more verbal, analytical, and a lot more orderly than the right brain. It's sometimes actually called the digital brain, and it's better at things like reading and writing and computations. Here's the mistake that we make, is that a lot of times we think people with right-dominated brain are the only creative people that are there. But if we are created in the image of God, then we have a full brain that includes the left
and the right. And even though some people have a more dominant right side of the brain or a more dominant left side of the brain, you still have access to each side of your brain. And creativity, it will seem more obvious and on display for those that are right side dominated in their brains. But the reality is this, is that those with a dominant left brain need just as much creativity to solve all the problems and analyze all the situations that they need to. Thankfully, God created us all differently. And so some people are right side dominated and some people are left side dominated. And it's great that God gave us different people with these different brains so that we can all work together. Can you say thank you to my two brains? Thank you so much, right side.
Thank you.
Of course you would. And thank you so much, left brain. It is I that is indebted to you for allowing me to function with such speed and efficiency. Regards to your spouse and offspring. And that's how God created us, with a left brain and with a right brain that work together, that have creativity in all that we are as people. But I'm so thankful that God created us differently, every single person differently, every person with a dominant left or a dominant right or a dominant center that manages to go through both. Why? Because together we're all the family of God being creative in his house. I want to share a real quick story. I want to read it today from Exodus chapter 31. I love this story. I want to pull a couple of points out and I want to celebrate the creativity that is in our church. Exodus 31, verse 1, it says this. The Lord said to Moses, look, I've specifically chosen Bezalel, son of Uri, grandson of Hur, of the tribe of Judah. I have filled him with the Spirit of God, giving him great wisdom, ability, and expertise in all kinds of crafts. He is a master craftsman, expert in working with gold, silver, and bronze. He is skilled in engraving and mounting gemstones and in carving wood. He is a master at every craft. And I personally appointed Oholiab, son of Ahisamach of the tribe of Dan, to be his assistant. Moreover, I've given special skill to all the gifted craftsmen so that they can make all the things that I have commanded you to make. And then Moses goes on to explain how to make the ark and the covenant, the tabernacle, all those incredible things that we find in the Old Testament made by all these men led by Bezalel. I want to pull a couple of thoughts out. The first one is this. God chooses who he gives gifts to. God chooses who he gives gifts to. It says here, the Lord chose Bezalel. He chose him. He specifically chose him. And we can see this pattern all throughout the Old and the New Testament, that God chooses certain people to give certain gifts to. We find Paul talking about this in the New Testament in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, where Paul begins to go through and explain all the spiritual gifts. And Paul says in verse 11, he says, it is the one and only Spirit who distributes all these gifts. He alone decides which gift each person should have. So we have all these spiritual gifts, and God goes through and he gives each person different gifts. This is where we have to understand the truth that we can never fall into the comparison trap. Because different people have different gifts and we can never compare. One of the girls in our church who I think is an awesome girl, her name is Ginger. And I've actually got Ginger here right now, and she's over here and she's painting. How you doing, Ginger? Great. Thank you, Ginger. Ginger, I've asked to start painting since the beginning of the sermon. I don't know if you can see this, but she's actually been painting since the beginning of the sermon, and she's going to paint for the rest of my sermon. What I love about Ginger is I love art. I'm just horrible at it. I have zero gifting when it comes to painting. And it's crazy because my father is an extremely talented painter. He is amazing. He's been painting for decades. He's a great painter. I love art. I love beautiful paintings like what Ginger is doing right now. But I don't have that gift. And so if I compare and go, well, God, how come Ginger's got the gift and I want that gift? Oh, you know what I'm doing? When I begin to compare what I have or what I don't have with what someone else has. What I'm saying is this: I don't trust and have faith in God that He's given me what I need to accomplish His will. And when it comes to creativity, it's so easy to look at other people that may seem more creative than us and say, well, God, how come you didn't make me be like that? How come you didn't give me that voice? How come you didn't do that? And you know what we're doing? We're actually living in a poverty spirit and poverty mentality. If you don't know what that is, watch my sermon from last week. But we're looking at a poverty spirit in our creativity. What are we doing? We're looking at what we don't have instead of looking at what we do have and what we can give. The worst thing about comparison is this: you actually never ever truly understand or know the weight that somebody else's gift actually puts on them. You know, there's so many people I know. We live in the Philippines, if you're watching from overseas. In the Philippines, we love to sing. And what amazes me about singing in the Philippines is that there are so many good singers, and there are so many people that think that they are good singers. And there's so many people that wish I had that voice. I wish I had that voice. But you'll never know the pressure that that person carries by having that voice, by always having to get up and sing. Anak, anak, sing, sing for the family. Sing, sing, anak, sing. Right? Why? Because you have you got that pressure that you have. Right? And that's just a little thing. But I'm talking about people that carry even a bigger weight of that, where we look at some superstars and some celebrities and go, oh, look at the God, how come you can't give me that creativity? But you don't know the pressure and the weight that they carry because of the gift that God has actually given to them. You know, when we're talking about creative gifts, we're not just talking about the arts, about, you know, musical gifts or multimedia creativity, design. The reason why we talk about creativity in that sense a lot is because it's more obvious when it comes to that. I mean, in our church, we have a department called the Creatives Department, which basically take care of all our photography, video, design. They're amazing. They're all here right now serving, making sure that this service can actually go. But the reality is this: when we talk about creativity, creativity is needed in every single area of our life. It's needed for those that are doing spreadsheets, that are in HR, that are a lot of those, you know, left brain type things that we're talking about. You need creativity to solve problems. You need creativity. As a parent, it doesn't matter whether you can sing, dance, or paint a painting. You need creativity as a parent in order to parent your children. If you're married, you need creativity to keep your marriage alive and to keep it hot and smoking and not be boring and predictable. We're all the body. You said amen way too loud on that, but I love you. As a body, we all have different levels of creativity. We all have a different outworking of creativity. Creativity, it's not just bound by the arts, but we need it in every area of our church. My second thought is this: when it comes to creativity, the anointing meets hard work. The anointing meets hard work. It says that God filled Bezalel with the knowledge. Moses came down off the mountain, and he heard this from God, and says that God filled him with this knowledge. This is a mistake sometimes that particularly people make within church when it comes to God, is when we treat God like he's the genie from Aladdin instead of God. See, when we treat God like he's the genie from Aladdin, we look at this story and we go, oh, God filled him with the knowledge. So Bezalel just woke up one day, he's like, oh, I'm a master craftsman. Give me some gold. I'm about to make a statue. Let's go, right? That's not what happened. Do you know what happened? God filled him with the knowledge. God filled him. It actually says God filled him with his spirit. And this is what happened. The anointing of God met the hard work that Bezalel had been doing his entire life. And when the anointing of heaven can come and it can meet the hard work that you put into your craft, to whatever God has gifted you or called you to do, when that comes together, there is nothing that is impossible, because the anointing of God means everything is possible and your hard work means it can get done. We all know people that are naturally gifted at something, but haven't put in the hard work. The moment I said that, someone just came into your mind. And what do we always do? When we see them, we go, oh. Right? We always, oh, I love sport. And I'm a 6 foot, 6'1", maybe, white guy that is intellectually very advanced in sport, but physically, I'm white. And so I've looked at other people that are so much taller or more gifted, and I see the gift that's there, but I see their lack of hard work that they put in. And I always get, oh man, if only I had that gift, right? If only I had that hard work. Then I've seen other people that are less talented, less gifted, but they're harder workers. And they end up going further and farther in whatever it is. It's amazing to me that they use the word master, that Bezalel was a master. You don't become a master accidentally. You become a master through hard work. And this is the part of the sermon people don't want to hear. They just want Aladdin to rub the thing and the genie, you know, comes down. You ain't never had a friend like me, and I'm going to give you, oh, I'm going to make you a master. Pachow! And we just become a master instantly. Now, here's the thing. God is all powerful and sovereign. And I've heard stories where God has just given people a voice or given people creativity. But that tends to be the exception to the rule. Do you know what the rule is? Work hard and let your hard work meet the anointing of heaven that comes, and anything's possible. When I was younger, I've always loved music, right? I love music. I love listening to music. We were just joking about me and Liz, because we're old enough to remember. We were joking about how we used to listen to the radio on our cassette players and do the record and make mixtapes. But when I was younger, my parents taught me how to play. Not my parents, but they gave me piano lessons. And I didn't know anything about how to play the piano at all. And so I used to play a little bit when I was a kid. I think I learned this song. Do you remember this song? Right? I learned that when I was like 8 years old. I had this Filipino teacher that used to bike to my house, and he used to teach me how to play piano, right? And then I gave up because I never liked piano. I was 20 years old, and I was in my parents' church in Brisbane, Australia. And the one piano player we had in the church, I started playing acoustic in the church. I kind of taught myself how to play acoustic, but that, you know, acoustic's kind of easy, just G, C, D, E minor, and you're good for every church song. Just slide that capo up and you're good, right? But piano, our one piano player left. And how many of you all know you cannot have altar calls without piano? God does not show up. I kid, but sort of, that God, you know, it's just easier to have an altar call. It's easier to have a ministry time in piano. So I remember I actually went and I began to teach myself how to play. I got a book and the book showed me where the keys were and then these little dots of where to put your fingers. Now, I'm 20 years old. This is before YouTube. I'm showing you my age. If I had YouTube, my life would have been so much easier. I would have had one of 1 million people going, I'll teach you how to play piano. Masterclass this, right? But no, back then I had this little book with dots on the keyboard. And so I began to sort of play and I really loved worship music. But I did learn one secular song and I played in the key of C. See, the great thing about the key of C that you can see here is that you can't make a mistake. It's when you start entering black notes, that's when it gets pretty crazy, right? Because you go, but in the key of C. So you know what I did? I just learned every song in the key of C. I transposed every song that we did in church to the key of C. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing, right? Power and majesty, praise to... You can sing like any song, in any song. Give me a song. Give me Reckless Love? Well, that's a different time signature. Liz just said Reckless Love, which is a different time signature. I'm talking, 20-year-old James didn't know how to do that. But 35-year-old, oh, the over, never end. Whoa, see, 36-year-old James is old, right? So I learned how to play that. I even learned some secular songs because I really liked it. And if you don't know that song, you're probably a Christian and going to heaven, so good on you.
but I learned, but I remember here, and then I started to add a black note. I did the key of D, which is this note right there. It's the F sharp, and so I began to do that key of D, and I would then add, it's also the C sharp in there as well, and I began to play, and as I began to add more black notes to my piano playing, I began to get a little bit better on the piano and play, and it was nice, and it was cool, and here's the thing, I got to a certain limit where I was good in church. People thought I was good on the piano. Here's the thing. For any legitimate piano players, you would understand that my form and how I play the piano is actually horrible. I'm actually a horrible piano player. I just practiced enough in order to get good enough just to play piano. If you want to be a master at something, you got to start when you're young. And you got to play hours upon hours upon hours upon hours. When they talk about these child prodigies, right? When they talk about these kids that are prodigies, they're not just magically gifted and they can wake up and play the piano. What happens is with a prodigy, they take the natural ability that they have and they add hard work and they add practice to it. That's why I will never be a great piano player. Why? Because I didn't put in the hard work. I just put in what I needed to do just to get by to play in church. And I practiced a lot, and I would stay up late at night and do it. And I love worship music, and I can play worship music, and I will be right here waiting for you. That's all I can play, right? That's it. But when you begin to actually combine hard work with the anointing of God, that's where anything can happen. Speaking of this, you know, within our church, to make this service happen right now, our church has a great anointing upon it. I love our church. I think we're an anointed church. But this doesn't just magically, poof, happen. There's been so much hard work that has gone into combining with the anointing of God on our house to actually make this service happen. Do you know what it takes to actually make this service? Well, I want to show you the hard work that it takes. So come on, come with me. So all you see is the perfect image of me up the front. But right here behind it, we got Pranav that's on our dolly camera. He's doing it there. We got a couple of other camera people that are over here. Julia and Alfred John are here. So these are the guys taking the shots. You didn't even know that they were there, right? Over here, this is where it happens, right? Up in the back, we got Randy. He's taking care of all the lights right now that make everyone look pretty. This is Kobe. Kobe's switching and doing the live directing that you can see all up in here. And then this is Miles, is our genius, right? He's already editing some of the Toglish service so that we can get that out to everyone through here, right? I want you to come follow me. Man, this feels like MTV Cribs, right? Over here, we got our sound guys. We got Mark on the live sound front of house, and we got Dan capturing all the sound so that we can put it on and record it. Without the audio, we got nothing, just a bunch of pretty faces. Come here. Come here. If you've never been to our church, welcome. This is our church. Here on our front desk, we got Marsh and we got Carl. These guys right now are on the database, so every new person that signs up to church, every person that raises their hand to say that they commit to Jesus, it goes through these guys. Come on, look up, smile. There you go. Look, it's working so hard they don't even want to look up. This is our parents' room, right? This is where we used to have the parents of the children in the middle of the service, but we got different people. Josh is up here. He's color grading already one of my old sermons. We got Pat here, which is doing the run sheets, making sure our service is okay. And we got Max over here, who's already planning for Favorhood. Kumu, check it out before and after the service. Hey, one more. Come through here. This is what you would never see. Ready? In here, oh my gosh, we got Mao, otherwise known as Meow, who's doing all our graphic design. He's working on Favor Youth Live right now. This is Yusel. Yusel is making all of this financially happen, right? He's our CFO. He's amazing. Look, he's even got a Microsoft computer. You know that he is a left-wing, left-brain kind of guy. And this is Kat, who's planning all our community care stuff and doing everything to help the community. See, when you tune in, and we got Chris right now. Look at Chris. He's trying to get out of the camera shot. When you try and do a service, right, you think all it is just one camera that's up there making it pretty. But you got to understand that when it comes to doing church, there's so many people doing hard work to make this happen, right? We got all these people coming together to make it happen. You wouldn't want to know what church was like if none of these people existed. Do you want to know what it's like when these people aren't here?
Welcome to reality. This is what I really look like, and this is how it looks without all the hard work of all the people that you just saw. Ha! Joke long! This ain't really how bad it is, but it's not much better than this. Let me show you.
See, this is actually what it would look like. I'm so grateful we have the most amazing people in our church that combine their hard work with their creativity. So this isn't what you have to watch every week. You don't have to watch it like this. In fact, you get to watch it like this.
And this is actually what the finished work looks like. I'm so proud of our team. Why? Because they haven't just relied on the anointing. They haven't just treated God like he's a genie, but they've combined the anointing from heaven with their hard work. I want to challenge you wherever you are right now, wherever you are watching this, that God has given you a level and a measure of creativity. For some of you, it might take a little bit less hard work because there's a full measure of it. For others of you, it might only be a little measure and it might take a lot more hard work. But whatever you are, whatever you're doing in life, if you can combine your hard work with his anointing, nothing is impossible. You can change the world. You know what I love? I love about the Bible, Bezalel, is this, is that he was so gifted that thousands of years later, we're preaching about how gifted he was. And if he was here right now, he'd probably be like, oh, all glory to God. But I would challenge him and say, yes, all glory to God for the knowledge and everything that he's given you, but good job on all the hard work that you took and that you combined with his anointing. My third, my last point is simply this, is that God's gifts have a purpose. God's gift has a purpose. You know, the creativity in our church, it has to be better than just looking cool. The purpose has to be more than just even trying to be fresh or be hip or be edgy at all. Our creativity allows us to be relevant. And if you heard me preach about this a couple weeks ago, you'd know what our definition of relevance is. Relevance is not trying to be cool. Relevance is trying to find common ground with somebody so I can connect and communicate with them. The whole point of our creativity that we have in our churches is twofold. One, we want to honor God with our creativity. And number two, we want to be relevant so that we can find common ground with people. Why? Not so that they can think that we're cool or it's great or wow, that's a really great video. Why? So we can lead them to Jesus. That is the purpose of creativity, is to lead people to Jesus, to honor God with the gift that he gave and to lead people to Jesus. You know, I told our church that in this season of COVID, it's been a crazy season, but I said this early on, and it was simply this, to dominate, which is actually biblical because God's given us dominion over this earth. And the reason why I really felt that word was this, I knew, and because the media was telling us that everybody was about to fail. Businesses were about to fail. Families were about to fail. The health system was about to fail. But in God's economy, we don't just come under what the world says. We live in God's economy. So I challenged our church that in this season, in a season where we should be failing like every other worldly thing, that in fact, we were gonna dominate as our church. And that is the purpose of our church, is to dominate the kingdom of darkness, so that we can bring the kingdom of light. And you know what's so cool? In this season, we've done just that. I love it because in this season, since March 15, I love that I can actually tell you that we've had 2,985 new people let us know and connect with us that it's their first time watching our church. Nearly 3,000 people. And I'm sure there's been thousands more that haven't actually wrote, but these are people that have taken the time to let us know and we've been able to connect with them. In the season where we shouldn't have been doing anything, we were able to graduate 112 people in our Build Foundation courses, which is amazing. We were able as well to graduate 207 people in our equipping survey of the Bible class as well. I love it because we had 362 people sign up to join a connect group. Not just say, oh, that would be a nice idea, but 362. in the last few months that I want to join a Connect group, sign up and gave their details. But you know what my favorite stat is? My favorite stat is this, is since March 15, we've had 310 people respond to the gospel of Jesus Christ, pray the prayer of salvation, which I'm about to give you a chance to pray, and let us know that they have prayed it. It's amazing. I'm sure there's actually been hundreds, if not thousands, more people that have prayed the prayer. But 310 people have actually come forward and said, I prayed that prayer. It's what happens when you combine the gift of creativity with the purpose of God. You know, I had a pastor ask one of our church members, simple question. The question was, how come there's so many creative people that are coming to Favor Church? They asked one of the members of our church, and that member came and asked me and said, yeah, this is what the pastor said. And I thought about it. And I said, that's an interesting question. And I thought that the reason why I think there's so many creative people coming to our church is because we actually honor the gift of creativity. You'd be shocked how many people don't honor the gift of creativity. What I'm really thrilled about for the Church of Jesus Christ in today's day and age is that the COVID pandemic, as horrible as it is, and I talked about this with relevance, it's forced pastors to begin to honor the gift of creativity. I've talked to pastors that never honored at all anything to do with videos, that they thought it was just for the young kids and we'll never do video. Whoever watches a video, now their entire church rests on the shoulders of 16-year-olds. I love it. And in our church, we honor. In fact, if you've been around our church, you know, thank you, baby. When we started our very first prayer meeting, which was in October in 2015, nearly 5 years ago, we had a prayer meeting. Nearly 4 years ago, we started our church with our services. I made a list of 10 things that I wanted to pray specifically for within our church. Here it is. I don't know if you can actually see it, but it's pretty cool. A couple years ago, Kate took, this is the original piece of paper that we had that we prayed off, and we left it on our fridge. There's pen marks on it here. In the back, I don't know if you can see it, but in the back here, we actually wrote some different possibilities of names for our daughter. We were thinking about calling her Sienna Jordan Aiton. I love Michael Jordan. Here it says Sienna Brave. That's the first place that my daughter's name was ever written. So that's pretty cool. So there's 10 different things, and I'm not going to go through all 10, but I'll probably pull this out every now and then because I loved it. Kate framed this for me, and she said, keep dreaming big, babe. Love your wifey. Oh, my God. Mahal na mahal kita. We can't kiss because of social distancing. Anyway, I want to read you point number 4 and point number 6. So remember, we've got a very creative church right now. We have creative people coming out of songwriters, actors, musicians, painters. How you doing, Ginger? Are you okay? We're going to come check in on you in a little bit, right? Here's what we wrote, number 4. Before we even had 5 people in a Connect group, in a prayer meeting, this is what I wrote. We want anointed singers and musicians with highly talented songwriters and producers that would write anointed, great-sounding songs in every season of our house. Young people would constantly be raised up and given opportunity to have worshipers. I'm so blessed that just a few short years later, we have, I believe, the best worship. It's my church, of course it is. And if you're watching from another church, I hope your church has the best worship for you. But I'm so proud of our team, led by Shello and PJ. I'm so proud that we've been able to see, you know what we've been able to see? Hard work match the anointing. And we've got some within our church, right? We haven't started doing our own worship songs yet. We're going to take our time. We're going to do it when we're ready. But wait for it. Favor worship is coming at you. But within our church, we have got some of the most talented songwriters, not in the country, on the planet. Some of the people in our church have had hundreds of millions of Spotify views and listens. I've got one right in front of me, Sabu. To look now, right?
We got some of the most incredible songwriters in the nation and in the world in our church. Number six, this was point number six. It was this, that we would raise up young men and women with a heavenly creative edge in the area of multimedia. Through video design and marketing, that we would be on the cutting edge of creativity. There's a whole bunch of other stuff. I'll read it another time. But I love that even before we had, even before Kate and I had three other people to pray with, we honored this gift of creativity because the world is changing so fast. In the last three decades, if you look at how fast the world's changed, we got to keep up with it. And unfortunately, this is what the church has done so often. We've looked to the world for inspiration. But I've always felt that there's a call on our church that the world would end up coming to us for inspiration. Why? Because we have direct access to the one who created man and woman in his image, who spoke and the world was created. We don't need to go to the TV stations. We don't need to go to the movie houses or the design schools. We've got inspiration on tap from heaven. And I love it because even within our church, that's already beginning to happen. Already I've heard businesses that have come and said to their people, look at Favorite Church and copied their Instagram. And even though it's small, I've gone, God, you're already that vision you gave me, that heart, I'm already seeing it happen. When we honor the gift of creativity, man, there's nothing that can stop us as a church. Why? Because creative ideas are endless. How are we going to preach the gospel in 10 years? I don't know. But 10 years ago, if you told me that I'd be standing up here right now looking in a lens and talking to thousands of people across the world, I never would have believed you. So who knows what's going to happen in the next 10 years. But this is what I know, that when we combine our hard work with the anointing of heaven, that creativity will explode and that the name of Jesus will be made famous in this world. You know how you get a direct access to God, a direct pipeline to heaven for creativity? That's what you got to do. You got to have a relationship with him. You know, the Bible talks about it so clearly that the only way that we can have a relationship with God is actually coming through his son, Jesus, by acknowledging what he did on the cross. And when you acknowledge what Jesus did on the cross, it's not just saying, oh yeah, I believe he died, you know, and rose again. Yeah, everyone kind of believes that. No, when you say that you acknowledge that Jesus died on the cross and rose again for the forgiveness of your sins, you're acknowledging that and you're putting away any other way that you can get to God. Which means this, your money can't get you to God. Your good works can't get you to God. What other religion that you're kind of sort of a part of, or that statue, or that necklace that you hold in your hand, none of that can get you to God. The only thing that can get you to God is coming to Jesus and saying, I acknowledge what you did. Forgive me of the sin that's in my life that has separated me from the Father. And when we pray a prayer and come to him, Romans chapter 10, Paul writes this and he says that if you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that Jesus is Lord, you will be saved. And I want to encourage you right now. Maybe you're watching this and it's the first time you've ever watched church before. Maybe you've been watching for a couple of weeks. You've never made this decision. I want to encourage you right where you sit. Please put your hand on your heart because we're all going to pray a prayer in just a moment. And I want you to pray this prayer with me. But as well, I want to throw this open to maybe you're watching and you used to have a relationship with Jesus. And straight away, you know exactly who you are because you just felt that conviction of the Holy Spirit come and hit you. Something happened. I don't know what it was. Maybe a church leader did something wrong. Maybe you got offended. Maybe life just got busy and you just walked away. I don't know what it is, but you're watching this right now and you know that you don't have an active relationship with Jesus. Come home to the Father today. If that's you, I want you to put your hand on your heart too. And I want you to say these words after me. Say, dear Lord Jesus, come to you today. And I ask you to forgive my sin. I acknowledge that you died on the cross, but you defeated the grave and you rose again for me. So right now I ask, please come into my life. Be my Lord, be my Savior, be my best friend. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Amen.
That's amazing. I want to congratulate you that if you just prayed that prayer, that is the single greatest decision that you have ever made in your life. It will revolutionize and change your life. But we want to know who you are. I want you to join that other 310 people up to today that have made that decision in the last COVID lockdown period. So please let us know. Whether you're on Facebook or an online platform, you can let us know in the box or in YouTube. Let us know. We want to contact you because a Christian walk is not meant to be done alone at all. It's meant to be done in family. This is how I want to end today. It's an interesting one. How do you end a service when you're talking about creativity of being a part of the culture of our church? Well, if you remember, the theme of this whole series has been this, that I don't just want to be a person that experiences the culture. I want to be a carrier of the culture. And if we bring that into today, this is what I want to challenge you. Every person watching this, you can be a carrier of creativity into any sphere of your life, into any point of your life. Right now, I want to go over and see Ginger just for a second to see how you're doing. How are you, Ginger? Let me see. This is beautiful. Can I take this? Can I hold it? I feel like it's a baby. Is it? That's okay. Okay, I'm not going to hold it. I just decided not to. What do you think it is? Tell me really briefly, because you don't just paint. Tell me briefly what it is.
Well, I feel like with creation, I think about God giving us the ability to create. And it does take a process. It's not just a one-time big thing. It's like a flower.
Beautiful. Oh, we have a mic. We're smooth here. How creative are we? No, that's okay. I think you heard me on that mic anyway. And I love it, the flower. Can you guys see that? Can you see it? It's a beautiful flower. And you've flowers. I don't know what that red is, but let's just call it the blood of Jesus, because that would just be amazing, right? I love it. So this is what we're gonna do. No matter how creative you are or uncreative you are, I want you to join in with us as we pray for the creativity that's on this house. If you're a part of Favorite Church, I want you to pray for your house and for your home, that the creativity that is already on this house would begin to expand in an even greater way, that those worship songs that are in seed form in this house would get water and begin to grow at some point, and we'd see Favor Worship go all around the world to reach people, that the designs that have never been thought of, the videos that have never been thought of, the sermons and the creativity that have never been thought of, that in seed form, that they would begin to grow in our house. So if that's you, if you want to be a part of that, come on, lift your hands wherever you are, all in this room, lift your hands. God, I thank you that there is an anointing on this house, that as we have valued creativity and honored you through that, that God, you have just poured out an anointing on this house. And we pray, let that anointing increase and increase and increase. God, I thank you for creativity in the arts, God. Lord, for painters and designers to rise up, God. For musicians, world-class musicians and songwriters, God, to rise up in this house. God, dancers that would dance under the power and the Spirit of the Lord, God, but not just the arts. I thank you that creativity can come into every sphere of life, for business owners and for business workers and HR managers, God, Lord, and call center workers, every part of life, parents, those in relationships, that creativity would come and would begin to come out, and we would honor you, God, through our creativity. So, Lord, I thank you for this house. I thank you for the anointing on this house, but God, I pray, let it increase and let it expand. Let your anointing meet our hard work. Let your anointing meet our hard work. You know, I want to end with this. Bezalel, this is what I love about this story in Exodus. I talked about the gift of God. The gift of creativity has a purpose. Bezalel, his purpose was to build in the Old Testament at that point for that nation, the house of God, the tabernacle that housed God. Now, modern day, this is the Church of Jesus Christ. It's our church. Purpose of our creativity, to build the house of God so that we can know God and make him famous all over this world. I really want to thank you for joining with us in church today, for being a part of this series. If you missed any of the sermons in the last 4 weeks, please go back on YouTube. We've got them all up there in 4K as well. Resolution, wow, so creative, 4K. And it's up there. Have a look. Remember, if you prayed that prayer today for the first time, please let us know you prayed the prayer. If it's your first time attending our service, we'd love to connect with you. And if you're in Metro Manila, we want to give you a bag to say thank you. We're going to deliver that to your house. So let creativity reign in your life and in your house. Have the best week you've ever had in Jesus' name.
Thank you so much for joining us today. We hope you enjoyed our services. If you raised your hand and prayed that salvation prayer, we would love to connect with you. So please scan the QR code appearing on your screen right now. Or you can message us at 0917-77-FAVOR. Or you can also visit us at favor.church/next so we can tell you more about the decision you made and so that we can help you on your faith journey. Hey, if it's your first time, we would love to connect with you. Our team will call you and we would love to give a gift to you. So visit us at favor.church/next. If you're watching online, don't forget to follow us, hit subscribe, or bookmark this page. If you're watching on iWant, why don't you give us a thumbs up? Or if you're watching on TV, thank you so much for tuning in. If you want to know when or where else you can catch our services, visit favor.church/schedule. That's it for today. Thank you for joining us. We'll see you again next week.